seeking first the kingdom of God just points out the fact that we were made for more than marriage. That's why we get bored with each other. None of us are so fascinating that we can keep each other enthralled for 5 or 6 decades. But if you're seeking first the kingdom of God, what I've found, that's what gives meaning to your life. We were created to impact eternity.
Welcome to the Focus on the Family broadcast, helping families thrive.
John, when it comes right down to it, I think every husband and wife secretly wants the happily ever after part of marriage. Now, we don't really believe in fairy tales, but there's this innate desire and longing, which I think is God-given, that wishes for something better and more loving and more intimate with your spouse. Admittedly, it's easy to get distracted by the busyness of life, and we can put marriage and family on autopilot and cruise along, thinking everything's going to be okay. But as followers of Christ, we know that our marriages are meant to be a spiritual symbol of something much bigger and deeper than we can even imagine. In Ephesians chapter 5, the Apostle Paul calls marriage a mystery and compares it to the relationship Jesus has with the church. So we really can't afford to take our marriages for granted. And the good news is that God does have something better, more loving, and more intimate in mind for you and your spouse. And we're going to hear about that from Gary Thomas today.
Right. He was our guest at a special event earlier this year on the campus where we interviewed him on the stage of our chapel in front of a live audience of about 40 couples who are friends of this ministry. The topic was Gary's book, A Lifelong Love, Discovering How Intimacy with God Breathes Passion into Your Marriage. Jim, here's how you began the conversation with Gary on today's episode of Focus on the Family.
Okay, you've written this wonderful book, A Lifelong Love, but I got to get right to it. You admitted that when you first got married, you did it for all the wrong reasons. I think I know what that means, but you said it was all selfish.
It was. It was a shocking time of prayer for me when I was just asked, I believe by God in prayer, why did you marry your wife? And there were a lot of reasons for me to marry someone like Lisa. She had so many good qualities. I loved the way she looked. I thought she would be a great mom. I liked the way her mind thought. I knew she loved the Lord. And I was like, well, she's this.
You know, you should have started with that one.
Yeah. Okay.
I'm just saying.
But it hit me that in many ways, I got married to Lisa because of everything that I thought she would bring to me. I thought I would have a better life if I could get Lisa to marry me, or if I could get Lisa to marry me than someone else. And while we all kind of make those decisions, it was just shocking to realize that it was selfishness that was moving me into marriage when I believe God designed marriage to pull us out of our selfishness.
Yeah. I think that's pretty normal for most of us, though. I think that's how we start. You know, we notice somebody that we're attracted to, and then it moves from there.
Yeah.
You used a term in your book called spider spouses.
Yes. Yeah.
So that sounds a little creepy.
Well, yeah, it is.
What's
it is.
A spider
Think
spouse?
Think about how nefarious this is. That this spider constructs this web for one purpose, to catch victims and then eat them. that's what
And what's the analogy to marriage? I'm sorry.
But in some ways, we construct these webs. How can I look attractive? How can I do this? How can I get you to consider this? So that then I can go and you can meet all my needs and I can feed off you. Feed off your affirmation, feed off your wealth, feed off sexual interest. I mean, there are a lot of different reasons that move people to get married. And that's it's really a disgusting picture to show our selfishness for what it really is. And again, if God's agenda in marriage is to pull us out of our selfishness, whatever led us into marriage, we have to realize, okay, if I want to go God's pathway into marriage, I've got to stop being a spider spouse. I've got to look at marriage from an entirely different angle, not to be a spider, but to be someone who blesses my
yeah,
spouse.
Yeah, that is so good. You go on to say in the book about 1 Corinthians 13 that's the marriage passage. I think many of us know that passage, but what stands out in 1 Corinthians 13 for you?
Well, how so often when people come into me for counseling, they don't realize how they are directly contradicting what Paul tells us to do in 1 Corinthians 13. Love doesn't boast, and they boast about how they're the better spouse. Love keeps no record of wrong, and the wife will say, do you realize when he was in college, he got fired from Taco Bell for this, and he got kicked out of school for that. And you got that. Okay. And if I would just read 1 Corinthians 13 right there, they go, oops. Because they're coming here with all the things that their spouse doesn't do. And I'm saying, well, yeah, that's true. And you're not doing anything that Paul describes as love in 1 Corinthians 13. And that's really what we look at marriage as, is that it's not that one person is right or wrong. It's how marriage helps both of us become more right, more loving, fulfilling 1 Corinthians 13. Because I don't think that most of us get married with the agenda that God has. And if I could just add on to when I got married selfishly, the other thing I think was so wrong when I got married is I thought my greatest need was to be loved. I loved movies, I loved pop music, I loved novels, and every one of them were in agreement that that was what was be fulfilling. I had to find that love. That was my greatest need. And I believe that God would have told me, no, your need to be loved has been met perfectly in the person of Jesus. No one can love you more than I've loved you. I died for your sins. I've given you my spirit who comforts you, who convicts you. If you start to do those stupid things, makes you miserable so you turn around and come back. And so if you were in Christ, I don't believe your greatest need is to be loved. Your greatest need is to learn how to love.
Well, that's a big paradigm shift.
Oh, it was months for me. It's like when this God dropped in, and I really struggled with it for months. But then I put in the scripture. I don't want people just to take my experience. There are so many verses that say love extravagantly. The love you have for everyone should be increasing. Love even your enemies. There isn't a single verse that says, to be fulfilled, find a romantic partner who will love you like you've never been loved before. So I think the silence of Scripture is very loud, and the overwhelming witness of Scripture is you need to learn how to love. I didn't get married for that reason, but I believe God wanted me to get married for that reason. And I grew in my appreciation and satisfaction in marriage when my agenda began to align with God's rather than trying to get God to give me what I thought I needed out of marriage.
Well, and again, with that paradigm shift, you also talk about a monk's marriage.
Yeah.
Now, I didn't know monks could be
That's
married.
That's a big paradigm shift.
Yeah, that is a paradigm shift. So first of all, I need that definition. What did you mean by follow a monk's marriage?
Well, it's a little bit of a creative thing, but I go off Psalm 146 that says, do not put your trust in princes, in human beings who cannot save. So let's go back 3,000 years when that psalm was written. It doesn't sound that shocking to us now because kings are sort of figureheads. Back then, kings had unrivaled, unquestioned authority. If they said you're poor, you're going to be poor. If they said, I want your wife, they got your wife. If they said you're going to die, you died. If you go to prison, they did everything. And so when the psalmist says, don't put your trust in a king that you can see, put your trust in God who you can't, it was a shocking thing because everything within you would say, I have to have favor with the king because he can determine my life on earth. And the psalmist is saying no, because in the end, he doesn't determine your destiny. You have to trust in the God who you can't see. So let's apply this to marriage. We put our hope in a spouse we can see, not in the God we can't see. How I tied it in with the monk, it may be the weird way my mind works, but you guys know I like to read the Christian classics. I would read these books of monks and nuns that had very satisfying lives because they were so in love with Jesus. And I thought, well, they're happy, but they're not having all, they don't expect a spouse to do this or a spouse to notice this or hear this or provide this or offer that. And yet they're so happy. So what if I could have this monk's attitude that I will find my fulfillment and joy and meaning and purpose and affirmation from God. And then everything my spouse gives me is extra. It's not an expectation. It's find my satisfaction in God. And so then, instead of being frustrated that I'm not getting this because I want that and that because I want that, it's like, I have this from God, and I get your smile too, or your kiss too, or your attaboy too. And because it dawned on me so often when we're dating, we have this attitude, wow, you got me flowers, you got this present, you sent me a card. And then the wife says after they're married, you got me flowers again? You got me a card that you didn't even write. I mean, the thing that delights you as a boyfriend or girlfriend can frustrate you as a husband or wife. It's all because of expectations. You don't expect in dating that they have to do it. Now they're a spouse and you expect them to do it. So you lose the joy. So it's really this way of saying, how do we recapture the joy in marriage by saying, Married people should be just as dependent on God for their satisfaction, for their affirmation, for their hope, their joy, their peace, and then marriage is added on to it, rather than try to draw the majority of our affirmation, satisfaction, joy, and peace from our spouse and go to church once a week and remember that God loves us and forgives us.
I think you're saying some wonderful things here. And I remember being criticized in a book I wrote about keeping your expectations low about people. That way your disappointments are pretty rare. And that's what I got criticized for. Daly's best advice is keep your expectations low. But you're saying the same thing I am, that in marriage, put your hope in God.
Yeah.
Put your trust in God. Now, let me just play, you know, the opposite side of this. It's great. It sounds wonderful in theory to be that in love with God, that all your needs are met in your relationship with the Lord. Lisa's sitting right here. Have you been able to achieve that?
No.
Sorry.
Here's what I've realized, and maybe this is why I write about it, because you see your own weaknesses. I often tell people my marriage books are the stories of my failures and God trying to call me out of them, to be honest.
Which helps the rest of us, by the
right,
way. Thank you.
And obviously, we have the same critics, because I recognize that voice. But I was reading the Philokalia. I don't know how you pronounce it. It's this Eastern Orthodox group for like 4th to 15th centuries, the great classical writings from the Eastern Orthodox Church. I like to read out of the tradition. And one of the things that keeps coming back if you read through that, and I love it because the West, sometimes they look at things different, or the East looks at things differently than the West, this lust for praise that they insist cannot be satisfied. Mm-hmm. And the lust for praise is every bit as strong as the lust for more money, materialism, the lust for excitement, sexual lust, gluttony. What they're saying is you start to give into it. If you need it, it grows. It's not satisfying. It demands more and more of you until it ruins you. And I never looked at my lust to be appreciated and desired and praised in that light as a sin and something dangerous until I was reading these great church fathers that mentioned how it was. I mean, I was a master. This is so pathetic. But one of Lisa's love languages would be acts of cleaning. Very much more
acts
specific.
Acts of cleaning?
Yes. I didn't find any Gary Chapman's
sixth language. Yes. I've not come across that.
She's
one.
Invented her own one, right? And so I knew this, and so I was a master. She was off somewhere coming back from a Bible study. She's usually at home at 8:30. At 8:27, I'm splashing some water in my face. I have a vacuum cleaner or broom in my hand or something, like I've been cleaning up the house. Just because if I'm cleaning, I want to be noticed by doing it. And realizing that if I, and I talk in A Lifelong Love about acts of secret service, which, and the whole point was how many wins I get. One, I'm able to serve my wife without her knowing it. And so I look for things to do that she'll never know about. It purifies my heart. Secondly, I believe there are heavenly rewards when we do good works out of secret. It turns my heart to think about how do I serve her instead of how am I being noticed or served. There are like five wins when you start to say, how can I be giving? I want to be the opposite of a spider spouse. I want to give, even if it's in secret, even if I'm not noticed for giving. And Jim, there's a joy from the Lord when you're loving his daughter out of love for him in a way that only he sees. And it's a whole lot more than you could ever expect from
a spouse. And we're going to unpack more of that, because I love that idea that you married God's daughter, so watch out. He's your father-in-law. But I also was caught by something that you mentioned in the book where you encourage spouses to become counselors for the defense side of the courtroom rather than on the prosecution side. Okay, I just got to say, we got a lot of married couples here. How many of us tend to work for the prosecuting attorney at times in your marriage? Anybody want to put your hand up? Well, look, nobody, just me.
I did.
Just
I did
John kind of. And me. All right, okay, three more. Okay, but how is that the case? Why do we not first go to defend our spouse rather than go to the prosecutor's bench?
Well, I believe a lot of it comes down to remembering and living out the gospel, 1 John 4:19. We love because he first loved us. And when I remember that God isn't my prosecuting attorney, that in fact he is my defense counsel. He's often defending me from me. I'm talking about myself in ways that injure God. He doesn't want me to talk about me the way I talk about me. But there was a story I just thought was brilliant of a woman. She was in England and she was complaining to the rector at the church where they were at about her husband was doing this and that and this and that. And he said, "I've been listening to you for weeks complaining about your husband. He goes, I just want you to do one thing for me. I want you to go back and I want you just to sit before the Lord and ask God why your husband might be the way he is." And she was like, "Oh, of course, he's a man. He's going to take the husband's side. This is just ridiculous." So she did, and God began to speak, and she went through the early years of their marriage just about what he went through with his mom dying and the humiliation of losing his job and having to move back in with his parents and all of these things. I don't have time to go into all of them, but she realized, she just felt so sorry for him. And she realized, okay, yeah, sometimes he might be short. Sometimes he might be impatient. And she goes, but look at the pressure he was under. Look at the shame he was dealing. And that never excuses Jim. And I know you know this. It never excuses a husband being short or sharp or inattentive. But sometimes I found that it's really helpful to say when we're most frustrated with what our spouse is doing, God, why is she acting this way? God, why is he acting that way? Not to excuse your spouse, but to understand your spouse. And often you'll hear that God's saying, you know what, not acting perfectly, but have you ever thought about this is the wound that they're carrying? And then we can be a part of healing, not by condemning them. I mean, look, prosecuting an attorney means you send your spouse to jail. Right. who wins with that? Understanding means you can help point the way to healing and greater intimacy. And I just think that's a healthier place to go in marriage.
Absolutely. I do want to pick up on that comment earlier about Lisa being the daughter of God and that transition. I think it was in a broadcast taping that we had done earlier that you had mentioned something like that. And I remember going home. Jean is always excited when I come home and I say, "Hey, you know, let's spend 10 minutes together uninterrupted." She'll say, "Who did you talk with today?" So I'm usually giving you a lot of credit. But this is one that I took away from our conversation some time ago. You know, when you're in the midst of a discussion, a heated discussion with your spouse, do you realize she's the daughter of God? Yeah. That changes your paradigm.
It has been the single biggest insight that has changed the way I look at marriage and try to live my marriage and the way I look at my wife. I was not being a good husband, and there are many times that was the case. And just in prayer, applying 1 John 3:1, "Behold, how great a love the Father has lavished on us that we should be called the children of God." I claim that as a single man. That's my identity. I'm God's son. No one can take that away. And God was pointing out to me, "Gary, it's also true of your wife. Lisa's my daughter. She's not just your wife, she's my daughter, and I expect you to treat her as such." And then when I had daughters, it was a whole new element. We also have a son, but I realized if you want to get on my good side, it's easy. Just be good to one of my kids, be kind, be loving, be their best friend. I'll love you if you're my kid's friend. And if you want to get on my bad side, it's just as easy. Be mean to one of my kids, shame one of my kids, break one of my kids' heart. I mean, my blood pressure will go up if I even see your name, because I'd rather you mess with me than one of my kids. And when I realized that's how God looks at my wife, as his daughter, in a holier and purer and more intense way, everything about my marriage changed. Because the reality is, the Bible promises us we marry somebody, James 3:2, who stumbles in many ways. Our spouses, in a worldly sense, are not always worthy of being loved. God is always worthy of being worshiped and revered. And when I love my wife out of reverence for God, because she's his daughter, there's always the reason to love her. I mean, I'll never run out of it. She's always lovable because of that. It's not the only reason I love her, but it's a motivation that goes beyond the fact that I stumble in many ways, that she stumbles in many ways. We honor the God who created us and we worship him through that. And so stopping to just think of God as my heavenly father and remembering that he's also my heavenly father in law has something that has just transformed the way I look at marriage.
You had that experience with your father-in-law, Bill.
Oh,
so
yeah.
Tell us that story.
Yeah. Well, is my earthly father-in-law, Bill, who I'll never forget the wedding rehearsal night. Bill's not a particularly emotional man. He wasn't. He didn't show emotions that much. But he cried talking to us at our wedding rehearsal night. Good tears. You could tell they were happy tears as he was just talking about how happy it was. And he'd never said anything. And then as we'd been married, he began fighting leukemia. And after about 7 years, it was becoming acute. And we knew he probably wouldn't outlive it. And so cancer's, I mean, everybody's been through it. It's so horrible on so many levels. The one thing that patients have told me is that it gives you time to prepare. You can have some conversations. Mm-hmm. And so we had some, and it came up, and I asked him what was going on about that, because I knew he didn't used to break down crying. And he just said, Gary, I looked at you next to her, and we were just kids. We're kind of shocked our parents let us get married at that time. But he just said, and I just said, Lisa's found a good man. She's going to be okay. I don't have to worry about her. And, you know, and I brought that up to mind when he called me the day he died and asked me to pray that God would bring him home. He was just tired of the sacrifice and the pain. He'd been trying to stay alive for us, but he was just at a point where he was just done. And I don't want to get too mystical. I knew he was going to call. I don't know how. I knew. And I knew what to say. I just reminded him of that. I just said, Bill, I just want you to know Lisa will be okay. I'm going to be with her. Because I knew if I was about to leave this earth, and Bill knew his eternal destiny was secure in the work of Jesus Christ, the one thing is, what about my loved ones that I'm leaving behind? And the best gift I could give him is to saying, the reason you cried on the day we got married, I said, it's even more true now. I will always be by her. I'll always make sure she's okay. And when I'm gone, I'm going to make sure she's okay. And he just said, I know you will, Gary. And that was some of the last words that we shared.
It's a beautiful illustration of a father's heart, but I believe the Lord, you know, sets life up that mirrors his heart for us.
Absolutely.
So again, his heart for Lisa is even greater than Bill's about how well taken care of she is. You believe every marriage should have a magnificent obsession.
Yes.
Mine happens to be cleaning my garage. Am I missing the boat?
Magnificent?
Does that fit in your definition?
Well, yeah. It's my wife's is cleaning the kitchen. So there we go. We can't leave the house if it's not obsessively clean, because we might die when we're gone, and somebody might see our kitchen when we go back. I always think it's funny. Anyway, the magnificent obsession is, I'm stealing that phrase from a classical writer several hundred years ago to summarize Jesus' words in Matthew 6:33, when he says, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. That word first is very important. The word seek is very important. In Greek, it's continuous present tense. Continually keep on seeking above everything else the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And it's my belief that that is the best agenda for a lifelong love, a satisfying marriage, because it deals with the two issues that brings most marriages down. I've been dealing in marriage ministry now for decades, and two of the things that I see, the first one that brings a lot of couples down, it's not some mystical thing, it'll almost sound mundane, but the reality is couples get bored with each other. They just drift apart, and then the kids are graduated, and they don't even have that to share anymore, and so they drop the kid off at college and stop at the lawyer on the way home and say, okay, we're done. Seeking first the kingdom of God just points out the fact that we were made for more than marriage. That's why we get bored with each other. None of us are so fascinating that we can keep each other enthralled for 5 or 6 decades. We're just not that. 5 or 6 dates you can. 5 or 6 years is a challenge.
I like that low expectation.
Well, 5 or 6 decades, it's not going to happen. But if you're seeking first the kingdom of God, what I've found, that's what gives meaning to your life. I believe God wants us to be discontent and listless if we're living a selfish life. We weren't created to live a selfish life. And living for romantic happiness is a selfish life. Living for just financial comfort is a selfish life. Living just to have even a happy family, in one sense, can be a selfish life. We were created to impact eternity, for God to impact eternity through us. And so what I found is that it gives you a reason to pray for each other and with each other. It gives a new respect. I tell husbands, if there are husbands listening, how do I get my wife to be impressed by me? Here's the easiest thing to do. Offer yourself in service to God, because you find out the Holy Spirit is real. And He will gift you if you make yourself available. And He will use you. And your wife will say, man, I didn't know he had that. I mean, it's just fun. And Lisa and I have even noticed this as empty nesters. Now that we've been empty nesters, we do a lot more together. And we started doing most of our premarital counseling together. So the first time I'm with a couple and there's this going on and I'm asking this and I'm pointing out this, and you got to look at this, and we get done. Lisa's like, wow, you're pretty good at this. And there was just this new appreciation or respect. But it's not me. I mean, it's just, you offer yourself to the Holy Spirit and He uses you. So I just say, if you want to get your husband's affection or your wife's affection, just get the Holy Spirit on your side. And you get the Holy Spirit on your side by seeking first the kingdom of God, which is why I say, don't worry about falling out of love. Neurochemically, that's going to happen. Worry about falling out of purpose. The second one is, don't worry about falling out of love. Worry about falling out of repentance. Because when I'm seeking first His righteousness, I'm becoming the kind of person a woman wants to be married to. I'm dying to the things that destroy most marriages: anger, rage, malice, lust, greed, all of those things that make somebody miserable to be around. And righteousness isn't just avoiding the bad, it's building the good of Christ. I'm growing in patience and kindness and gentleness and love and understanding and humility. Those are the things that somebody wants to be around. And so by seeking first His righteousness, I'm becoming the kind of person that somebody else wants to be around, which ultimately builds my marriage. And I'm just telling you, as a pastor, 90% of the issues when somebody comes into my office, it's an issue of character. Somebody is acting with anger or lust or a lack of self-control, or spending is out of control or whatnot. And so if we would follow the magnificent obsession, build our marriages on purpose and righteousness, we kill the two things that destroy most marriages.
Some profound observations from our guest today, Gary Thomas, based upon his book, A Lifelong Love, Discovering How Intimacy with God Breathes Passion into Your Marriage.
Yeah, I really love how Gary keeps pointing us back to the solid foundation of God's Word. Because let's face it, our popular notions of love and attractiveness and passion are all self-focused. It's all about me. And in effect, we're ignoring God's plan and design for what marriage should be. As believers, we need to be mindful of this issue because we are Christ's representatives to a watching world. How you interact and treat your spouse will determine whether or not your faith is seen as legitimate and real. That's why I recommend Gary's book, A Lifelong Love, to you and your spouse. Whether you're newlyweds or you've been married for decades, this is an excellent resource that can take your relationship to the next level and help you grow in your faith as a couple. I think single adults will benefit from this book as well. And I'd love to send you a copy in exchange for a gift of any amount to Focus on the Family. That's our way of saying thank you for supporting and encouraging marriages today. And I invite you to do ministry through Focus. Give generously so that together we can respond to the hundreds of thousands of couples who will contact us for help and resources for their families. And we need you, and I look forward to our ongoing partnership.
Our phone number, so you can donate and get Gary's book, A Lifelong Love, is 800, the letter A and the word family. Or just click the link on your screen. And if you'd like to evaluate how your relationship with your spouse is going, we have a great tool at our website. It's a free marriage assessment that helps identify your strengths as a couple and offers some insights about areas you might need to improve. Again, click on your screen to learn more about that assessment. On behalf of Jim Daly and the entire team, thanks for joining us for Focus on the Family, and plan to be with us next time as we once more help you and your family thrive in Christ.